How were you about?
I'm sorry, yours was your left, right?
Yeah,
mine was right.
Okay,
so. A little bit different.
Matchy.
You guys make it. You might make it mirror each other. It was crazy that we're joking about it, but
I mean,
but in some ways you kind of have to, right?
Otherwise, you're crying.
I have laughs.
It's me too.
So, what about mammograms? Were you? I'll start with you, Ananda. Were you good about getting your mammograms?
You know I wasn't.
I know you were, but I wanted you to.
With the doctor attached to it.
I wanted you to say it.
Ananda Lewis is living with breast cancer after finding a lump in her breast nearly 6 years ago. You'll know her from her time hosting BET's Teen Summit in the 90s and for being a VJ for MTV. She's also my best friend after we met at the start of our freshman year at Howard University.
Hey, you know.
You're bisons.
No, you did it just for me because I hate the word bisons because it's not a word.
It's,
and she needs an S for her gators. But
also one of my closest friends is Sara Sidner, the fearless, truth-seeking journalist and CNN anchor who is more comfortable reporting from chaos than she is focusing on her own needs. We've been tight ever since she moved into the office next to mine in Los Angeles more than a decade ago. Last year, she too discovered something in her breast that turned out to be stage 3 breast cancer.
Rewind.
But Ananda has family members with breast cancer. Do you have family members with breast cancer?
No. My mother didn't have it. My mother's mother, my mother's mother's mother, my father's mother didn't have it. Like, I don't know of breast cancer in my family.
Yeah.
And so the doctor, I said that to him. I'm like, he goes, does it run in your family? They ask you it on all the forms, mm-hmm. you know, all the stuff. And I said, no. And he goes, so how did I end up getting it if it's not in my family? He goes, about 95% of people with breast cancer don't have it in their family. I'm like, then why do you ask? Because we all think we're safe.
Yeah.
So only 10% of any cancers are genetically caused.
Because I did do some research on that. And what is interesting is, yes, the same number I saw was about, the vast majority has nothing to do with
nothing
the fact that the family members had it. So the emphasis that needs to be on that in our communities is massive. And you're looking at people who have come from very different places who are both experiencing this pretty much around the same age. Like, how old were you guys when you were diagnosed? You were?
47?
51.
Is it just last year?
Yeah, hers is just last year.
Yeah. Ooh, it's been a busy year.
Last year, and mine was almost 6 years ago, January 2019. But honestly, if you have a tumor, you can feel that tumor's been growing for a long time.
And I mean, even up to a decade. I didn't think about that. I didn't know that like centimeters or millimeters mattered.
Yeah.
And when you hear like, well, if you're this to this, you know, I need to go back and look exactly what date, but it was several months after I had gotten a mammogram that I discovered it. And this has been bothering me. So I'm just going to say this. So the American Cancer Society does not recommend self-exams anymore. They don't prioritize that as a thing. And I just think that, and I get why, because you just said it. Sometimes the mammogram's false positive, people get worried, they do treatments they don't need to do. But to me, if you can tell, you know your body.
Yes.
If you know that there's something wrong and you're able to catch it earlier, I mean, it could have been stage 4 if I had been like, I don't know what that is. I never touched my breast. I had no idea,
blah, blah, right?
So. I feel very strongly that we need to know our bodies, that we need to be able to touch ourselves and make sure you know what it is that you normally feel like and what is abnormal and go get checked. Because otherwise, the doctor's not at your house every day.
Nope.
He doesn't know what things are normal and what's not. He doesn't know if you're feeling good or not. Like, you have to advocate for yourself so much. And I am terrible at advocating for myself. Mm-hmm. I will advocate for you. I will advocate
you're
for
you. You're
actually
happy to do
probably better than us.
I will fight someone. Like, I am a ride or die bee.
I love
that. I will fight someone over certain things.
Right.
But when it comes to myself, I will be silent. Mm. I won't do anything. I will sit there and take it in and take it and take it. Mm. So this has been a real lesson for me to self-advocate. And when something like a medication or something is wrong and I'm having a reaction or whatever, that I don't just go, well, I guess that's just the way it is. Now I'm like, okay, so what is this? I'm feeling this thing. I looked it up. It's called this, that, and the other. To the doctor.
Yeah, and what can we do about it?
And I know he is so sick at WebMD. Like, I know he is mad at WebMD.
They're all mad. They're all mad at the internet searching. They're all mad at it.
He's like, don't go down the okay, you already did.
You're in the way.
I said, I told him, I was like, I was taking notes the first time I met him, and I was like, okay, so, and then say that again? Okay. I was like, okay, now I need to know, am I going to die? And he was like, okay, whoa. I need you to answer that question.
Come on back.
You will be fine. And that's the first time I cried.
Because he finally had the release.
He says, you're going to be fine. You're going to get through this. Mm. And I was like, what? But before that, I was peppering him with questions. I was going for him. And I was like, wait, I'm going to gain weight? I will kill you, sir.
Yeah, you went into reporter mode. You're like, but wait, and then I gain weight.
I said, what did you say?
You said,
He said, yeah, we're going to give you some, you know, steroids while we're giving you the treatment. So usually my patients do gain weight. I'm like, is there anyone else that can help me? Because I am not gaining. You are not making me fight cancer and gain weight. No. And he was like, okay.
So I'm not going to fight cancer. I'm going to fight you, guy.
Yeah, pretty much.
But it's like, everyone's got a thing. And this is clearly her third rail. Like,
no. He was like, were you this mad at cancer? I said, I am now. Sir, you just said I'm going to make it, but and I'm going to gain weight? No, we're not. God. No.
No, that's too far.
So, yeah, it was.
When you talk about our women, black women being the most susceptible for dying for this, there are a lot of things tied up in those two things that make that statistic make a little sense.
It does.
Our inability to be comfortable with doctors goes way back. We have a rightful distrust of the medical industry that we do need to get over, but we are not going to negate that it came from somewhere.
No, and that it still exists and that it's passed down in oral histories among families.
Absolutely.
That's real.
And I've had friends that have gone into doctors. In fact, a friend I just lost to breast cancer who did everything she was supposed to do, exactly like she was supposed to do it. It kept coming back and she was asking the right questions, but because there was a communication, not barrier, we all speak English, but we do speak different kinds of English. You know what I'm saying? And so you might get in somebody in front of a doctor, not just a somebody, but in front of a doctor who culturally doesn't understand or respect the way you communicate. And that's going to create a further barrier. And touching our breasts, being comfortable with our bodies.
Which is a huge part. And to be honest, I didn't know until I touched your tumor.
She but met I my had tumor. To be,
so it would have to be that close to somebody.
Yeah.
Right? To be like, and then when I touched it, I was like, that's completely different than anything else I felt before.
Right. Yeah.
What we need to also clarify, though, is because you've mentioned sort of, we've alluded to it, is the routes that you've taken. And Sarah, you decided right away, you were like, all surgery, do it all. What was your decision?
I was like, get this out of me. Cut it out, chemo it out,
burn it out,
burn it out, choke it out,
tickle it out, coax it,
whatever you have to talk it out, whatever you have to do, get it.
Get it out.
Yeah. And do it now. I want an immediate response. I want it right now. It's like a microwave, 1 minute, boom, bing.
Give me my poo. Not done. 1 minute.
But that's what I had in my mind. Mm-hmm. I am a person that when I hear a problem, my immediate response is fix it. Let's fix it. How can I fix it? I do it to my mother. I do it to you. I do it to my husband. I do it to my friends. I do it to strangers. Like, what happened? Okay, so that you lost your job. Have you tried? And I will try to solve that problem right there.
Yeah. That's so funny because I'm like that too.
Immediately. Yeah. And what I suddenly learned, very hard lesson for Sara Sidner, is that it wasn't going to be immediate. Mm. And I had to deal with that. And I was pissed.
Mm. Like, and you disappeared.
I disappeared. So this is what I do to my friends now that she's telling all my business.
Put it out
my
there.
My grandmother says, don't tell people your business, but here we are.
And here we are.
And here we are. So when something is difficult for me, and when I am either just extremely mentally taxed or emotional or getting depressed, I go silent. Mm-hmm. So my good friends, my really good friends know that I stop talking. Stephanie will be like, what's going on? Because suddenly I'll just disappear for 3 or 4 weeks, like just not communicating with anybody.
Not a joke, so not a thing. Alone. But guess what? Because apparently I just require all my best friends to be the same. She does the same thing.
I do.
Why
does it take it so long?
And then I will send a text message and I'll be like, you good? Because we don't talk on the phone every day. In fact, I don't talk to you on the phone. When I call her, she's like, Stephster, what's up? Because you never call. Same
thing. I always pick up. If I don't pick up the phone and she calls, now something's really wrong with me. Like, now she's like, we got to call the police.
Because I don't call right now.
I'm worse than you because I won't pick up.
You just don't.
It's this, I don't know what it is, but it's like, I want to figure this out so that I have an answer as to not hurt my people. So I need to know the answer to something so that they don't have to worry. Mm-hmm. It's this, I don't know
but
exactly.
But it's
problematic.
It's so interesting. But you're trying to manage your people who care for you.
I know.
Which is part of the, I think part of the conversation about the cancer journey is that you are in the midst of needing care, but also caretaking at the same time. And it's different because you're also have a teenage son.
Mommying.
Yeah. So it is real, right? But I feel like that's a lot of it. And because you're both out there double dutching, doing so much, you get to a point where it's like,
I think for me, the shutdown happens because I need all the energy other people require from me. Yeah. So if you're going through something like this and you don't cocoon, I've seen that happen, and you're too much energy is slipping out through these either random, unnecessary conversations, like no disrespect, right? Mm-hmm. But many of the conversations are not necessary to what you're going through. Right. Nobody's coming with you to an appointment. If they are, then they're catch-up conversations are like, tell me how you are, but do you have time to talk about it? I don't have time to talk about things I'm going through. I need the energy to get through it. And so that's why I shut down. And then I'll come back around when I'm able and be like, oh, here's what was going on. Like, unfortunately, I hit a stage four. It took me a very long time to talk about that.
Stage four?
Stop. Yeah. You can't just say that like that.
I was using it as like an example, but you're right. But listen, it's not, see, I don't even look at it as that deep, but when that happened, it was October of last year. I was doing so good. And then I got really lazy. And the way that I've chosen to handle it, you really can't get very lazy. You cannot take your foot off the brake because that sucker will gas on you. And it gassed on me. And I just didn't talk about it. What I did was went into action mode. Like you're talking about going into fixing. I do that, but in my own. So I'm like, oh, shoot. Well, I'm going to have to, I got to, and I can't talk about that if I'm using energy to figure it out. So that's my silence comes more from needing that energy for what I'm doing. And then when I can bring my head up, I'll talk about it.
You were, shall we call you the traditionalist then?
Yeah.
You did full conventional.
I did. Because you had cancer in one breast.
Correct.
But you decided to do a double mastectomy.
Correct.
Did you? Okay.
Yeah. Goodbye.
I was like, you're not going to have a chance to cause me a problem.
You're not coming back in this other, you might come back in the chest wall, whatever. There are things that can come back, but you're not coming back in the other breast. I'm not going to be doing this all day long, worrying about what this lump is.
Yeah.
I am done. Take them both out. Coloss.
Finished. And you still feel good about your decision.
I do it again and again and again and again.
Yeah.
We are so similar in some ways.
And so different.
Complete opposite on that one.
Yeah. So what did you choose to do, Ananda?
Nothing. No.
Yeah.
I
at first, yes.
At first I said.
Yes. As a friend, yes. At first, that was her choice.
Girl, I would have choked you out.
It was stressful. It was very stressful.
I only remember. Which is why I didn't talk about it much. But like, why do I want to torture you?
Yeah, because you're going to hear it. But here's the thing. I remember when you were diagnosed, and it was not until quite a bit later, it was months later, I think, that you told me.
It was right after my birthday when she told me. Yeah. Remember?
Because I waited. Stressed. I was like, I'm not telling you that
for my birthday.
So Ananda's cancer had progressed to the point where doctors recommended she have a double mastectomy. When faced with that, she opted to try alternative therapies.
I was ready to call you and cuss you out.
You and about 1,000 other people.
Okay. So now that that's out of my system.
And some of her family members.
Yeah. But my sister is a physician. She was like, what the hell is wrong with you? Like,
and a survivor.
And a survivor. She's the best survivor I know. My sister did every single thing right. She did her mammograms consistently. She found it at a zero.
I didn't even know that word.
Me
either.
Yeah. But like a zero. You can. They took the little bit of it and boom. She did the Tamax whatever thing with the hormone and bam. She is
good
brilliant
to go.
And good to go.
Your plan in the very beginning, did you know exactly that you were always going to be anti-mastectomy, anti-surgery?
I don't want to use the word anti because I'm not against it. I see the necessity of it. I see the effectiveness of it. I know people who it's worked for, my mother being one of them, you being another, because I'm claiming that for you in
so
advance,
far.
Even though you're not all the way out the woods. But, and my cousin, like, I know people it's worked for. But this journey is very personal. And you have to do what works for you and only you. And when we talk about what to be afraid of, and he said, no, you're not gonna die, you know, of this. When I was in the traditional oncologist's office in the very beginning and I asked all these questions and I said, well, how did I even get here? Like, what happened? What do I need to change? How do I need to eat? I was already 3 months into a cleanse. And I started doing my own research way back when my mother was diagnosed and trying to figure out what the body's doing this. This isn't an alien coming down and laying an egg in me. This is my body did this. And so that there's something to understand there. Mm. That's the path I took in the beginning was let me figure it out. environmental toxins. The science is saying emotional stress. The science is saying all the reasons, the whys of cancer are starting to become clear. And if we don't start addressing those, the other stuff is a half measure for me, to me, which is why I didn't do it.
Okay, so what did you do? What was your plan of action?
What was your plan?
My plan at first was to get out the excessive toxins in my body. I felt like my body is intelligent. I know that to be true. Our bodies are brilliantly made. They know what they're doing. And we mess them up, whether we know how that we're messing them up or not. I decided to keep my tumor and try to work it out of my body a different way. Looking back on it, I go, maybe I should have, because it was little.
Like, girl,
but I didn't have good options. They wanted to take both. They wanted to do all these big things that I was not ready for. So I did detoxing. I completely changed my diet. I started working on my emotional landscape. So, you know, when you're trying to turn a huge ship in the ocean, you have to slow that sucker down first. You're not flipping a 180 like you're in a Porsche. You're going, So I had a slow it down period that I felt was very effective. And then COVID hit.
That's right.
None of the stuff I was doing was accessible to me anymore. Couldn't go do that. Everything closed. And even the ultrasounds I was having done monthly to make sure I was watching, monitoring, seeing what the tumor was doing, seeing how it was reacting to things, making sure it wasn't going, from my opinion, too far. Because if you talk to a doctor, they'd be like, girl, you've been too far. What are you talking about? For me, what too far was. And then all that stopped. So that left me in a full-on lurch. Like, what am I about to do? And so I began to look at the healing, like the full picture of it. In the beginning, I had this little sliver, and then pieces started revealing themselves. And I was like, oh my gosh, all of this has to be a part of it. All of it has to be a part. My sleep was horrible.
I was going
to
say, it feels like
I drank too much alcohol.
Right. Apart.
Everything was falling apart. Yeah. But I was learning in the process. Yeah. And as things fell apart, it was catching the things I could use and throwing away the things I couldn't. And then I got down to this kind of more manageable table full of things I could do. You know, like action. When you talk about wanting to have control, that was one of the first things I was like, yeah, ain't doing nothing to me. I'm going to do it.
Well, and also,
I'll take care of it.
Well, I'll talk about it. No one keeps notes like Ananda Lewis.
Okay,
so she will have
like
seven books in.
Have a notebook and be like, and then at 11:07, I breathe 13 extra times in a minute. Like, she writes down every little tiny thing. And she's like, I looked at a lime today. I did not consume it. And she'll like write it down. Like, she,
I wanted to have it, but I didn't.
Listen, how many times I went to the bathroom? How many times?
Everything.
All of it's in a book.
And when we would meet up with our kids, you know, to do family time, she brings her food.
Yeah.
So when you say that someone's dedicated to this life, most people wouldn't be able to do that.
I'll tell you right now.
But I will tell you,
you were like, I'm not
that person.
I can do it to a point. But then
after that, I'm like, sugar. Yeah.
Honey,
come
I
on.
See.
Ridiculous.
All of it.
Sugar, well, honey, I even got to that point.
Okay.
Okay.
And then I had to be like, well, so first, COVID happened, tumor kept growing. I could feel that because, you know, it's right there. And then I had to go get some help. I was like, okay. The food, the supplements, the things. I gotta get more.
So were things
guns
changing? Were you seeing the tumor grow then during this time?
My whole breast was.
And so is that when you went to Arizona?
I did.
And so what were you getting done there? What was happening?
I'm integrative because of a little bit of conventional and a lot of natural. I got IPT, which is insulin potentiated chemotherapy, genetically targeted. So they're using.
In Arizona, Ananda detoxed, going through more alternative treatments, in conjunction with targeted chemotherapy, which she says helped her improve.
So you get down to a stage two.
Mm-hmm. Then I ran out of money and help.
Okay.
I mean, let's just be real.
Yeah.
The way I've done it is, girl.
And also,
it's expensive both ways.
It's expensive both ways, but it's also the time.
Will insurance for two things.
Will insurance cover it?
Will insurance cover it?
Mm-hmm.
That's A.
Mm-hmm.
Usually holistic, different.
Absolutely. Not a damn thing.
Yeah.
And do you have insurance? So I feel like, when I talk about this, I always say this. I'm like, now imagine what this would be like if you didn't have insurance. What would you do?
Girl.
And I still, to this moment, yes, there are all these different groups that can help, but the truth of the matter is, imagine being highly stressed about paying for saving your own life.
That you need to do now.
That you have to do. That this is not an option.
Well, I actually even take issue with mammograms and insurance because you are covered for one mammogram a year, but if they find something that they want you to go back and check again, well, that's a whole nother bill that you have to pay for that mammogram.
Absolutely.
And so if they want you to come back, people who don't have the means for that aren't going to go back in. And so it's it's cost prohibitive.
Yeah.
The way it's structured right
That's
now.
That's right.
It hurts everybody not to be preventative.
Right.
And yet you have to get sick to get help oftentimes.
Absolutely.
You get one mulligan, you get one gimme.
Yeah.
Right.
And then
that's it.
You're kind of like, okay, well, if you're not sick, then
yeah,
we're good. And so, then you get sick, and then it costs everybody
way more
money.
Tons
of dollars,
money. Right. If we could have just done it the way your sister did it. So you get down to stage two.
Couldn't keep up with the things they sent me home to do, which were continuing to keep my body. Those things were, you know, some of the things I had done before, some new things, couldn't do any of them. Other shifts happened, you know, in other relationships in life. And I just couldn't do it. Plus, I felt good. So then I got lazy. Then I was like, oh, girl, I can't keep up this keto anymore. I need to. I just, you know, I took my foot off the brake, like I said. And that, well, for me, it was a break because I was trying to stop stuff. But yes.
Yes, I see what you mean.
Yeah, sort of break.
Break, yeah. I see it.
But yeah, I just started letting my life be normal again. And that felt really good because this takes everything. And I wanted something back. You know, and it was like, I need to focus on my child. And I just, for probably, what was last year, 2023. So I got down to a 2 in 2021. And then by 2023, and this was out of nowhere, because January 2023, I was still good. And I was like, yay, okay. But the bit that I held on to, the things I could control, some of the food, I'd be back and forth. You saw me. Some days you'd be like, what are you eating today? I'd be like, everything.
Yeah, sure.
And the next 2 weeks later, I'm like, back on keto.
Yeah.
So I'd be back and forth trying to, you know, manage. I could still feel everything. So I don't know. I can't even say what happened. I don't know. I mean, cancer has a funny way of just continuing to grow. But also, I could have been, I don't know, exposed to some other things. Maybe I did some things that put more toxins, but I don't know. In October of last year, that scan showed that I had this kind of up my spine, through my hips, down almost everywhere but my brain.
And you had it. Tumors.
So
did you have places?
Oh yeah.
You had on your body. You were feeling it, right?
Yeah, my neck here. Oh, you could see these were swollen. My lymph system really flared up, and so all through my abdomen, all those lymphs were very flared up. My collarbone. It was bad. It was like it was the worst I'd ever been. I wasn't in pain until I got the bone scan. And that was the week of your birthday party.
My birthday party.
And then the night of her birthday party,
she was in pain.
Oh my gosh.
I was like, you didn't have to come.
But I did have to come. I wasn't going to miss that. But I got in my car after that and cried for like 20 minutes before I could drive. The pain was, I've never been in pain like that in my life. And it was the first time I ever had a conversation with death. Because I felt like this is how it ends. You know, I was like, okay, so I don't get afraid of things. I was just like, fudge, man, I really thought I had this. You know, I was frustrated. I was a little angry at myself. I was like, I don't want to leave like this. And
you freaked me out.
I sat there and I literally talked to him, the idea that I have of what death must look like. Just, and I said, man, listen, I know you're coming for me at some point. But I don't want it to be now. And if you could just wait, I promise when you do come, I'm gonna make it fun for you. We're gonna have fun. And I literally had that conversation laying in my bed. I couldn't get out of bed for like 8 weeks. I fractured my hip in the middle of it because my bones were very
brittle.
Susceptible.
Yeah.
I mean, just so many things started going wrong. But when you talk about, by that time I had my insurance back and I was able to both jump back into some treatment. During that break, I got a bone scan, and that bone scan, and nobody will corroborate this for me. I know the doctors don't say, well, these scans can hurt you. Maybe they can't. All I know is what happened to my body. The morning after I woke up from that scan, I couldn't walk, and I was in the worst pain of my life, and I had a home birth. And I'm a good, like, my pain tolerance
is
pretty wildly high.
So I've learned that my pain tolerance is high.
Because
I have no idea.
You didn't think you could go through.
And they're like, you feeling okay? I'm like, yeah, I'm good. And they're like, okay. You know, like what?
It's supposed to hurt.
Okay, well.
I'm good.
Okay.
That's good.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's good, but it's also scary.
It's terrifying.
And also, because it was your birthday when I took you out and you were telling me, you know how she just tried to tell us right now that she's stage four?
Yeah.
She did the same sort of thing.
Oh, I know.
And said it kind of fast.
Mm-hmm.
And
just my perception of it is
different.
I'm not trying
different.
To avoid
I know,
it. It's just not a big deal for me.
I'm just going to give you some facts.
Here's what I have to. Oh,
yeah.
Thank you.
And then she started talking about death, And I was like,
that's a hard conversation.
No, it's,
I'm
but
comfortable.
I'm okay talking about death. I think about death all the time.
Me too.
I think it's also because of our job.
Yeah.
Right? Uh-huh. Like what we're doing, I'm constantly thinking about it and thinking about what I need to do for my daughter. I think about it weekly.
Yeah.
I think that's important.
Weekly.
Mine might be daily.
Yeah.
I mean, not
I'm
just
daily.
Trying
to, I'm just
daily
trying
for
to
sure.
be.
Yeah.
Honest. I'm trying to give it time and say weekly, but it's probably way more often than that.
I think that's true for so many people.
Yeah, I think about it all the time. But I also was afraid that you were losing the fight. That's what I meant. Because I was like,
yeah, my energy changed. I hadn't dealt with any pain before with this. I was like, oh, no, this wasn't a part of my life.
Yeah.
This is not what we're supposed to be doing. Yeah. So that threw me, it threw me for a loop, but not one that I couldn't handle. You know, here I am. But what it did was made me eligible for medicines because then I was a stage four. And now they weren't talking chemo in conventionally more. They were like, you don't even qualify.
Right, I have a question. So at stage four, because I did not understand metastatic breast cancer, like I all these terms.
Yeah, they're
weird. I hear them, they go in and out of your head when it's not you.
Right.
Right? You're like,
that's right.
Okay, metastatic.
It's not relevant.
Okay. Does it mean that you can ever get rid of it? Like, what happens at stage four?
I don't know what conventional believes, but my beliefs don't line up all the way with that anyway. I needed some medicine for sure, but I think the reason I'm not having a lot of the side effects that many people on the same meds as me right now have is because I'm also doing the acupuncture Chinese medicine approach. I'm also doing other things. I keep up the integrative side because it's important for my body to feel good going through the other stuff.
So,
but it's all working.
I have to say.
But so stage
when
four,
I first
though,
heard
but stage
one.
Four, let me just be clear though. Traditionally, they
I'm
say
sorry.
Stage four,
right.
You don't ever leave it, right? But
yes.
So, I mean, and obviously you're doing much better now.
Much better.
Right? And like that all the tumors and are down.
Yeah. Almost, some of them are almost undetectable now.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So I just want to make sure we just finish.
Yeah.
Where
on
you
a better
are.
Note.
Yes.
Yeah.
On a higher note.
Sorry.
On a higher note. But what were you going to say? Sorry,
well, it just, when I think about it, like, it's terrifying to me, like
is
to
it?
Listen to you say this and then all of a sudden, it feels like all of a sudden, I know there are time in between, but like all of a sudden you're in pain and you're feeling, and there are tumors. And like my worst day, one of my worst days was getting the bone scan because I did not understand why I was doing all this. But when they told me like, oh, if it had have been in your bones later on, then we would have been having a completely different conversation.
Right.
And I'm like, say what, who, what? Because I'm like, okay, I'll go to this scan. I'll do this scan. I'll do, you know.
You're still running around doing
I'm
your
still
stuff.
Doing my thing. I'm fine. I'm okay. Like nothing's happening. Hair's not coming out. Like nothing's happening.
Yeah.
And they're doing all this stuff. And then all of a sudden you're like, wait, so what would be different with the bone scan? Well, if we found it in your bones, then you would be stage four. And then there would be this different conversation that we'd
have.
Down
the hospice road eventually. Yeah.
Pretty
that's
much.
What they want.
Like.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It would have been like you'd be living with cancer for the rest of your life. And I'm like, what? Now,
I mean,
now, to be fair, I know someone that has metastatic breast cancer and it's been 17 years or something.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
So survivable. Yes.
Absolutely.
I mean, we are all going to go.
That's right.
Yeah.
We are. And it's something that I think about way too often. And this was before cancer, but with cancer.
You think about it way more.
I think about it a lot more, and I think about how.
Mm.
But the thing that still messes with me, it fucks with me, I'm sorry, I'm cussing, is the idea of how much this is going to hurt those around me.
Yeah.
And I can't get that out of my head. Like, how do I mitigate that?
Mm. You don't.
You can't.
Well, you're supposed to help me and have an answer.
I can't help you with that, girl, because people who love you are going to be devastated no matter how, no matter when, if they lose you. Just like you're going to be devastated no matter how, no matter when you lose
them.
But that is
a fact or whether it's cancer.
Of his life.
Yeah.
We cannot escape that.
It bothers me that we can't fix that.
I know.
You know
it's unfortunate, but
it's
real.
And even if we're all thinking about death, it's another thing to actually look at, I may be in this world without my Sarah. I may be in this world without my Ananda.
Yeah.
Right? And who you women are to my daughter and how much you mean to the orbit of, and I don't talk to you guys every day, but I text with you guys just about every day.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I'm hoping through this conversation, other people will take the time to look at their health, see what they can do. You have a brand new haircut. How are you adjusting to this?
And it's cute.
It's cute.
I'm about to cry. Then you don't talk about my hair.
Because
I look like an auntie.
She wanted to pull you out.
Okay.
You look like
auntie
an auntie who's
baby.
Here. You're
auntie,
auntie
who's here, honey. I might be in the club with my gray hair, but I'm going to be there.
Look.
Yeah, I haven't had my hair this short since I was like five. Literally five. like, and I didn't like it then. But I'm here.
Yeah.
And the thing is, it turns out the aunties knew what they were doing because I get up and it's like
easy, done.
Girl.
7 minutes.
Yeah.
Throw some gel in there, wash it, and kabam. I'm like, hello, I'm ready to go. Like, I'm not hot.
Right.
Except for the hot flashes.
Oof.
But yeah, and everything changes.
Yeah.
It is a true journey. Is it a hero's journey? I have no idea. And I like what you said about not wanting to use the word fight or battle. And I've been battling with that because yeah. What we are saying to women or anyone with cancer, what we are saying to the patient is this is your battle and your fight. And if you lose it, you lost the battle. Mm. So we're putting that on people. It's like you are in the midst of trying to deal with something in your body. And we're saying, your responsibility, you fight it or you lose.
Mm.
We shouldn't be talking about it that way.
Yeah,
it turns it inward. Like it's all on you. You fight this. And if you don't, oh, she lost her battle with cancer. Like she lost. Mm. Like
you lost.
What are we doing?
No, you, if you extended your life, you won.
Correct. You did. You're on a journey.
Yeah.
The journey is not easy.
Right.
But you know what? Life is not easy anyway.
No, it's
with
not
or
meant
without
to be.
Cancer.
Right. And you don't live regardless to, I mean, you know?
Right.
You nobody gets out of here alive.
Right.
That is just
so true.
Not going to happen.
That is
so
true.
Your ability and responsibility is how you're going to thrive. My quality of life was very important to me. We've had that conversation before. Like there's certain things I know I'm not going to be okay with. And I know myself. Mm. I want to be here.
Yeah.
And so I had to do it a certain way for me. Right. And so far, I won't say so far so good because there was that spot in the middle, but now we're back on the so good.
The fact that you, like, I want to be here. I've had times when I didn't want to be here.
Me too.
Right. And so.
You mean in life?
In life.
Yeah.
I didn't want to be here. I didn't want to go through all this.
Because of this, during this journey.
Before this. And then this journey came along, and it's so weird that it was cancer that was like, I want to be here. Mm. I insist on being here, and I insist on thriving, not just being alive, not just existing. I want to thrive in a way that I have never felt before. I am too old to be feeling this now, and I am pissed with myself. I am pissed with myself that I felt differently in my 20s and 30s and 40s. And now with this, now I want to live. Really? This is what it took. Like God is trip. God
the
is
sense
a
of
trip.
Humor is definitely like for real. Lord, okay.
Yeah. And having to deal with it at some point, right?
This is my lesson. Like, I feel like there was, everyone's like, oh, there's a reason for everything. And sometimes I'm like, Shut your darn mouth.
Yeah.
Okay. Like people die. Like, no, like this is like life. I get it. But I think that for me, I am looking at this as this is part of your journey. And with this disease, you can talk to people differently. Yeah. You lived through it. You are living through it. You are living with it.
Yeah.
And you're thriving with it. And I don't want people to just survive it.
Yeah.
I want them to be able to thrive. With it or without it, I want them to be able to thrive. And I'm trying to be the example for myself.
Of the two of you, you can get sad.
I get depressed.
You get depressed. Mm-hmm. That's not really your MO. You can get frustrated with things. But what's interesting to me is that you both are saying that you have found, is it to appreciate life more now that you're going through this? Or is it joy?
Mine is joy. And I didn't realize how little joy I had in my life.
Mm.
Like I didn't realize that was not a priority in my life. Why the hell not? Because everything else was more important. Career was more important. This was more important. Going and doing this for someone else was more, all of that was more important priority wise in my mind. And all of a sudden I had squeezed out about this much left for joy. And I just wasn't feeling it. I actually said to someone in the grocery store randomly, so I knew I had a problem. Person came
Because
I randomly talk to people.
The deep thoughts.
I do talk to just anybody, just everybody, whoever.
This is fast. Or any animal.
Yeah.
She will talk to them too.
I'm with you on that.
She will say to me like, D-N-E. I'm like, what? She's like, do not engage. We are just going here for 5 minutes.
You have it. So it's our code word.
You need parameters.
We'll know. She's like, deity. I do not engage. Please do not stop and talk to the horse on Hollywood Boulevard.
You have to stop and talk to the horse.
Obviously. Like, what is she
talking about? Because the horse has been calling out for you, baby.
But also, what does it say about me?
I'm not Dr. Doolittle.
What does it say about me? Because
we need to hang out more sound.
Because you both are like animals. Like, and I love animals too, but you guys, like, I'm like, yo, on a mission.
I'm like, oh, come here. She goes, we have 5 minutes. We are live. 5 minutes.
Girl.
It's very true.
It's true.
It's very true. Right?
It's funny because my set point is joy. And like you said, I pretty much have but things have definitely, you know, if you can't get taken on the roller coaster of life, you ain't living. We're
correct.
Here to do this,
correct.
Right? You're learning,
that's
you're experiencing, true. You're growing, you're changing because of the influences, because 100%. Of the ride. And so that part has always been okay with me. I think for me, why I'm more joyful after cancer is because this, and you know, we've had other conversations where, you know, I'm not really into the diagnosis names and all that. I think there's too much power given to those to make people fearful. But I use the words because I know people understand the words. That said, the cancer diagnosis caused me to change things in my life I never would have changed otherwise, that I needed to change but would not change. And those changes have allowed me access to more of my joy more of the time.
But I want to thank you both for being open to this conversation, because I think you will have helped some people to maybe just check themselves out.
I hope so.
To also help people who are supporting them understand what you're going through.
Yeah.
Because I think that's a huge part of it, is caretakers don't know what to do, how to do it, and how
to
best
support. Don't be mad when your person goes quiet.
When they go quiet.
Doesn't mean they're
not okay.
But
just check in. But just let them know that you're still there and that you love them. And I can't imagine my life without either one of you. And I know someday that may be a thing, but right now, I'm happy you're both doing better and you're thriving, and I love you both.
I love you too, Steph. Thank you so much for having this. This was important.